The following is a presentation of TFNN. Time to talk about your health. Living a primal lifestyle.
You know, we have Tom on from Tampa on the phone. Hey, Tom. Good morning. It's bright and early now, huh?
Hey, Paige.
Hi, Tom.
How you guys doing, Nico?
Doing great.
Good. Hey, your newsletter's outstanding, man. I'm telling you, man, it is outstanding. And so is the Run 'Em All Edge. I love that stuff. I'd never be without it. I mean, I've been on it now 3-4 months, man. I mean, it's just, I can't get over how good I feel.
Primal Edge is, people are raving about it. People who are trying it, they know because you can feel it.
We'd not be without it.
Call now, toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-445-1044. Now your hosts, Nico DeHaan and Paige Clarke.
Good morning, I'm Nico DeHaan. Welcome to Living a Primal Lifestyle, where we explore a return to a more balanced, natural, wild world.
To recover our natural health, our rights, and our freedoms. And I'm Paige Clarke. Good morning.
And it's a beautiful morning in downtown Clearwater, 65 degrees, a little cloudy. We're going to have some rain coming in, but all in all, it's pretty nice in here.
And if you have any questions, you can reach me at Paige at TFNN.com.
And me, Nico, at TFNN.com. And you're taking your phone calls at 877-927-6648.
We get to talk about Ötzi.
Ötzi, is that the way we pronounce
Ötzi,
it?
Ötzi.
The Iceman.
He is from the Alps between Austria and Italy. And it's a man that researchers today decided to name Ötzi because he lived almost, he met an untimely and suspicious death, and his frozen and mummified body was discovered nearly 11,000 feet in altitude and melting from glacial snow in 1991. But he gives some real indications as to the fact that perhaps grains were not a good thing.
Well, one of the things is that, of course, this happened in 1991, and everybody was thrilled. We had like a prehistoric man.
Yeah, because he was found really intact.
Yeah, and it was over 5,000 years ago is when he was living, and that's kind of when we think Europe was still in the prehistoric age, mm-hmm. because we know the Middle East got agriculture about 10,000 years ago, and then it kind of slowly moved. But when they started taking this guy apart and looking at him, he was about 46 years old, 5'2", which was a fairly average height for his day. And evidently, he was a person of some higher stature
due to the quality. Yeah, he had some trinkets and so forth that indicated that he had stature in the community.
Yeah. What's real interesting, even though he lived several thousand years ago, he was clearly not a prehistoric or a paleo guy. He was more a Neolithic, which is, means agriculture.
Neolithic meaning he was living an agricultural way of life.
Yeah, even though he may have hunted for some of his food. And Nora goes on to say in this article that agriculture didn't do this guy any favors.
There you go. And yeah, this is from our friend Norga Gatis from Primal Body, Primal Mind, and she always shares great research.
And yeah, she mentioned this in the book too. And for starters, he apparently suffered from severe tooth decay.
Which is what we see with grains in agriculture.
Yeah, and he even had the grains stuck between his teeth when they discovered the body. Along with the lousy oral health, he also showed signs of arterial sclerosis and advanced arthritis.
Connecting some dots, Nico?
Yeah, and if we look at the picture here,
been portrayed by the media as a prehistoric human, but his state of health was decidedly forged by the dietary pitfalls of an agricultural-based society.
Yeah, so when we look at teeth of our prehistoric ancestors that have not delved into eating seeds, we find their teeth are pristine.
Perfect even. I mean, dentition, that's what Weston A. Price found too.
Yes.
Yet, and this is what bothers me, is so many people, perhaps on the vegan persuasion, you know, because they're looking for something to supplement their diet with, they overdo these grains. And then they wonder why their health is suffering.
Yeah, and when we say vegetarians, that means eating vegetables. Actually, most vegetarians aren't really they're not really eating that much vegetables. Most of the paleo people I know eat a lot of more vegetables. Most of these people who are vegetarians eat some sort of grains to supplement the protein. They have to, in a sense.
To kind of make the complete protein.
Yeah.
But we're not picking on any diet. What we're trying to do is find out what is the optimal real human diet. But according to his stomach contents, bread was part of his last meal.
Hmm.
And despite what whatever hunter and gatherer he may have done along the way, he clearly wasn't paleo, as you said, in many of his dietary choices. He was basically modern enough to have suffered some of the earliest diseases of modern civilization, again, 5,300 years ago.
Yeah.
In short, he was an agriculturally influenced medical mess, as Nora says.
Yeah, and here it says grain consumption has been linked with allergies, food sensitivities, autoimmune disorders, now numbering excess of 100 different identified so far, and 40 additional diseases thought to have anti-immune component. Here's that anti-immune system thing mm-hmm. that they come up with that now is kind of a disease, mm-hmm. but it's really a symptom of very...
the body is trying to find the culprit, which, you know, Dr. Marshall always says... We are alone in this world, in this country that's focused on this whole autoimmune.
Mm-hmm.
It's an infectious, inflammatory agent that the body is actually not, it's actually doing its smart thing. Did you notice this? His short stature and ill health was actually typical of many post-agricultural societies. So those of us shorter, we had ancestors that were indulging in the grains. And guess what you see? Short stature, wider waist, insulin resistance.
Right. Early agricultural people commonly suffer from mineral deficiency associated with disease like rickets, stunted growth, bone mineral disorders, osteoporosis, skeleton abnormalities, malnutrition, birth defects, dental
malocclusions, and degenerative diseases.
And these are things that are directly linked to seed eating. And you know, people get confused. I think
yes, with including whole grains, as Nora says.
Well, not only including whole grains. I think 5,000 years ago, that's all they had. They didn't have the machinery to take off the outer edges, and not until about 3,000 years ago did we find that the Chinese were scraping these things by hand just to get the starch. And I found an interesting thing I found on the web the other day when I was doing research into rice. The first instance of rice being used with food was actually completely different than the sushi we see.
Mm-hmm.
They use the rice and they covered the protein or sometimes the vegetables with it, and then they covered it with leaves or even mud sometimes. And what happened is they used the starch so the bacteria could ferment.
They fermented that rice.
Yeah, and somewhere along the line, what happened was the food was going away and people started eating the rice. They never ate the rice in the beginning. This is really news to me. I always suspected it, but I really didn't know the process. And here I had in front of me in a book a whole chapter on how they started fermenting these foods with rice.
It's amazing when you go down the rabbit hole. Here you go. Cereal-based diets also commonly led to numerous vitamin and mineral deficiencies and not typically shared with the Stone Age ancestors, such as pellagra, scurvy, beriberi, as well as vitamin A, iron, and zinc deficiencies. Again, these were deficiencies that never showed up in the animal food-based populations, but when you started eating the grains, these minerals were leached out. It's amazing. Guys, you know, it's more clues as we look past, we can get an idea what is the ideal human diet, and that's what we're trying to do, is find foods that kind of help us thrive.
Yeah, the picture becomes clearer and clearer, and I really applaud Nora for this book. The first book really opened my eyes. The second book really lays it on the line that I don't care what you eat, folks.
I just got it. I mean, it's fantastic, Nora's new book.
Yeah, it just lays it on the line that we were really meat eaters and we were really using animals. Folks, we're going to be right back. Mm-hmm. I encourage you to pick up our Primal Edge, $89, and get it to your door every month. This is our one-shot wonder with fulvic and humic acid. We're finding out a lot more about fulvic and humic acid and how important it is to tell our cells to open it up. Also pick up my Health Circle newsletter. Great article about how complaining can rewire your brain. Tell your wife or your husband about that. You know what's cool? Taking something that's good for you. Something specifically formulated to help with weight loss, better sleep, stress reduction, and the need to detox.
Nico, our hunter and gatherer ancestors found all their nutritional requirements for health in their wild environment. But today, our food sources no longer contain the vitamins, minerals, and nutrients our bodies need to stay healthy and strong.
That's why we need Primal Edge Daily Nutrition. It includes a special blend of ionic, soil-based vitamins, minerals, fatty, and amino acids in an easy-to-use liquid form.
Primal Edge is powered by highly concentrated fulvic and humic acids, nature's preferred delivery system. They have been called miracle molecules because, like sunlight, air, and water, life cannot exist without them.
That's right, Paige. They ensure we receive all the nutrition we need to be healthy and thrive.
We take it every morning. Primal Edge, formulated and approved by Nico and Paige of Living a Primal Lifestyle. Buy it today for just $89. Click on the Primal Edge banner on the front page of TFNN.com. Platinum, grains, crude oil, gold, copper, cattle, hogs, gasoline, natural gas, coffee, cotton, cocoa, and sugar. These are just some of the commodities mentioned in the most recent issue of Andy Hecht's Technomental Commodity Report. Andy publishes his weekly newsletter every Thursday morning, where he breaks down the commodity market and provides his subscribers with specific trading recommendations based on his trading methodology. By signing up for a free trial to the Technomental Commodity Report, you'll get a full 30 days to try out this powerful newsletter service and see for yourself the types of trades Andy has recommended for his subscribers. When you sign up for a 30-day free trial, you're under no obligation to pay anything. And should you decide to continue, you'll lock in the low rate of only $79 a month. Sign up right now for the Technomental Commodity Report and make sure you're ready to catch the next big trade in commodities. For more information and to get started today, visit the front page of TFNN.com.
Are China A-shares hot or not? If you trade China A-shares, now may be time to take a closer look. Trade CHAU or CHAD, Direction's daily CSI 300 China A-share bull and bear ETFs. China A-shares in either direction. Visit directioninvestments.com today. An investor should consider the investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of the Direction shares carefully before investing. The prospectus and summary prospectus contain this and other information about Direction shares. To obtain a prospectus or summary prospectus, please contact Direction shares at 866-476-7523. The prospectus or summary prospectus should be read carefully before investing. An investment in the funds is subject to risk, including the possible loss of principal. The funds are designed to be utilized only by sophisticated investors such as traders and active investors. Distributor Foreside Fund Services, LLC.
Nico and Paige take your phone calls. Now, toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-445-1044.
Welcome back to Living a Primal Lifestyle. We're talking about Oitzi, who is our prehistoric Neolithic man who, after his death, and incidentally, I think it shows that he was potentially murdered, was his cause of death. But we really see the evidence of the results of switching from a hunter-gatherer diet to an agricultural one, and the damage in his body that resulted was the result. Because, as we mentioned before the break, grain consumption has been linked to allergies, food sensitivities, autoimmune disorders, numerous cancers, pancreatic disorders, mineral deficiencies, diseases of the brain and central nervous system, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And when we contrast this with the primary cause of death in more Stone Age hunter-gatherers, accidents and infection were the cause of death.
And probably,
but what we see
birth.
Here in this closer time period was he was suffering the ill health, the medical mess, as Nora coined it, as a result of eating these foods that were not the original human foods.
Yeah, people today are being diagnosed with disease 33% faster than their grandparents of just 15 years ago.
Yeah, age 30 is the new 45 in terms of chronic degenerative disease.
Yeah, so we're
disease.
Actually living longer, and we say that the 70 is the new 50, but if you're at 50 not in too good a shape, that 20-year period is not going to be very good for you.
I saw a talk show where a guy said that we were dying longer.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of sad.
Yeah.
In other words, we've got these chronic diseases, but we don't have to, and that's what we're all about here. We're trying to say, how do we thrive as humans? So, what we know is that as long as we survive, that we stood pretty good odds of making it to an old age without the chronic degenerative diseases when we were eating a Paleolithic diet without these inflammatory foods. But this, when these foods got introduced, this was not the case. The degenerative disease presented themselves, and they persist today because that is the staple of our diets.
Yeah, and even though agricultural lifestyle allowed us to be probably protected more,
safer,
more controlled environments, and today we're wondering if that's the case. I was looking up because we a lot of talk about terrorists and stuff like that, and how terrorists are coming in. And so I looked at Homeland Security, see exactly how many people have been killed by Islamic terrorists since 9/11. course, 9/11 we know is almost 3,000. But since then, so that's almost what, between, so 15 years we're talking, 145 people.
Right.
So that, you know, more kids get killed in a school bus without seatbelts.
Right.
Than they do
and
with terrorists.
And more people are dying from chronic disease from our lifestyles
so
than anything
else.
So
I think we're really a lot safer in this society, but one of the things we do want to clarify is that you need to be able to protect yourself. That's one of the things that, as before agriculture, we were all about, the spirit of being a warrior, being able to protect your family, looking out for them, being able to hunt, doing all the things that are natural to us. These are important things. And, you know, I'm in jiu-jitsu, so I know how to take care of myself, at least to that part of it. But I think it's important to be able to protect and not rely on a government, whether it's local or even...
Handing out their seeds.
I mean, local, it makes more sense to me. You know, I'm protected by the guys that are in my neighborhood, the police that go around there.
Right.
But the federales, I don't think so.
Listen to this, Nico.
Okay.
So, like you said, even this agricultural lifestyle wasn't exactly our fast track to optimal health and longevity. And as the human populations exploded, ultimately leading to planetary overpopulation issues we face today, life expectancy actually declined by half relative to our supposedly short-lived Paleolithic forebears early on into the agricultural revolution.
Yeah. And this is mainly because of those accidents and the infection. So we did die younger many times, but when we did live,
we lived a healthy life. Right.
And we lived probably just as old, or perhaps some indication is that we have skeletons that are probably very healthy, even 120, 130 in both worlds, even the new world and the old world.
But the life expectancy was seriously shorter for the Neolithic or the agricultural eating man. According to this article, in fact, between the Neolithic Revolution and the late 18th century, human life expectancy never exceeded roughly 25 years.
Yeah.
So you think of that, that's, you know, I always think of the movie Romeo and Juliet, and they were getting married at 12. I mean, that's because that was halfway into their life.
Yeah.
It's amazing. What basically improved longevity in more modern times, you know, sure as heck wasn't our back-breaking nutrition and health-compromising agricultural lifestyle, but instead... Apart from being protected from predators and the elements, there was better technology, there was sanitation, and modern economic growth.
Yeah. Mm. Of course, the other thing that agriculture brought us is the lockup of food and the surplus, probably a little surplus before when we knew how to ferment things and put things in packages like the rice so we could have them during tougher times. But the real locking the door on people and protecting the food started with agriculture because we had such an abundance. And it makes sense that we wanted that. But what did that bring? That brings us closer into city. When we get real close, we have the pests that come along with us, which means we have more disease.
Right.
We have the agricultural foods that everybody's eating because they're kind of forced into it because the hunting is no longer there.
Listen to this, Nico.
Yeah.
When researchers compared the health of farmers versus hunter-gatherers, they found that the farmers suffered much higher rates of infection. Due to the concentration of stationary human populations in the farming communities, and they had much poorer nutrition due to their increased cereal intake and reduced meat and fat intake. They had problems with mineral absorption, and Neolithic farmers were shorter, had shorter statures. So those of us that are shorter, I mean, we were probably from a strain of people that became, you know, adapting these Neolithic agricultural lifestyles. They had many more health-related issues and a lower life expectancy relative to Mesolithic hunter-gatherers.
There you go.
And
I still contend, too, that the social structure changed for some for the better because we felt more protected, but I think over the long run we see now that we're really living apart from nature, and this is the whole divide when we get religion and we get politics involved into our plan, then we have groups that kind of battle each other for control.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to control the food because that's
Here's
the only way
that
we can
says
control
we also,
the people.
We also became more vulnerable to famine. And, you know, I've been kind of interested in this whole Irish Holocaust. I've sent you some things on Facebook.
Right.
And that agricultural, you know, lineage that we have, we have a cellular memory of famines, mm-hmm. I believe. And yeah. you'll see a lot of the Scotch-Irish and people that had their food stolen from mm-hmm. them. You know, it wasn't necessarily, the famines were often imposed by governments.
Well, it was always that way. I think people with agriculture, if you wanted to defeat somebody else, you held the food back. Mm-hmm. And I mean, even in sense, like when we go to Haiti and drop off all the wheat and everything for those people,
because they can't. We're doing them no favors.
No, but they can't grow anything, so yeah. we're kind of holding them hostage. This is your only food supply.
I know, it's scary, isn't it?
Yeah, all the great pigs that they had there that were natural there,
right.
you know, were killed and they were brought in, and all the pork belly pigs were brought in, which ravages the whole place. I mean, there's a lot of stories about that.
But, so agriculture anyway. Shifts our macronutrient content from a focus on dietary fat and protein to a diet based far more upon carbohydrate intake. The impact on human health in this regard has not been trivial, folks. Only in modern times have we humans developed an emergency need to lower blood sugar through the unnatural, chronic, and metabolically dysregulating release of insulin. Coming back full circle.
Yeah.
We were never designed to tolerate being marinated in a caustic and inflammatory mix of glucose and other sugars and insulin 24/7, and that's what we have. This is great. You know?
It's not great to eat, but it's great to talk about.
Yeah.
Folks, we'll be right back. The number here is 877-927-6648. Stick around.
We'd like to tell you about the personal training studio that Nico is the owner and president of, Performance Training. Since 1998, Nico has trained individuals and groups to improve their health both mentally and physically. As a certified personal trainer, Nico's main focus is on demonstrating exercises correctly to avoid injury and teaching his clients how to manage their past injuries while getting the most out of their personal training sessions. The Performance Training Studio is filled with unique training equipment that enhances balanced results at a faster rate while minimizing damage and discomfort. For more information, you can give Nico a call at 727-418-8740 or email him at nico@tfnn.com. Let him know you heard him on TFNN and save up to $100 on a special package just for TFNN listeners. Act today.
Tiger TV is an exciting way to experience TFNN programming. See high-definition video, giving you crystal-clear charts, as well as seeing some of the faces of TFNN's highly acclaimed financial experts with crisp, full-fidelity sound. Catch Tom O'Brien, John Logan, Steve Rhodes, Basil Chapman, Larry Pesavento, Think or Swim, David White, Andy Hecht, and Daryl Martin in crystal-clear, high-definition audio and video. Tiger TV, exclusively at TFNN.com.
Has the current market volatility continued to stop you out of trades when the market spikes against you? Now is the perfect time to open up an account with Nadex. Nadex, the North American Derivatives Exchange, is a brand new, completely regulated Chicago-based exchange, and unlike most other exchanges, Nadex allows you to trade directly through them with direct market access when using their completely free trading platform, which also features real-time charts and full customization capability. One of the advantages of trading with Nadex in volatile markets is that your risk is always capped and you have the ability of keeping your trades open even when the market spikes against you. Nadex is completely brand new with a line of unique trading products that are unavailable anywhere else. See how it works at nadex.com. That's nadex.com. Or click on the Nadex banner on the front page of tfnn.com. Futures and options trading involves risk and may not be appropriate for all investors.
Many of our new listeners have heard about The Tiger's Den, but wondered, what exactly is it? The Tiger's Den is a lively community where professional traders and investors can meet, exchange ideas and information in a comfortable, moderated atmosphere. Hear all of your favorite TFNN shows, plus see all the charts as they happen live during those shows and have access to all those charts. You can test drive The Tiger's Den absolutely free for 30 days. It will greatly enrich your knowledge of these markets. Details on The Tiger's Den are on the front page of TFNN.com. This segment is brought to you by Think or Swim. For more information, just click the Think or Swim banner on the front page of TFNN.com.
And welcome Welcome back to the show. And we're kind of diving into this Iceman that was discovered in 1991 in the mountains between Italy and Austria, actually where your Will is from.
Exactly, right in that area.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So agriculture really costs us big time in as a species. We've spent the last 500 generations or less, and that's less than 0.4% of our evolutionary history doing what we call agriculture. After we spent about 100,000 generations, which is 99.9% of our time, on mostly meat and fat diet, eating a diet that is demonstrably and increasingly unnatural to our species.
That's worth repeating. You know, 99% of the time we have been eating a meat-fat diet, and only 0.4% have we been eating these grains, and look what the disaster has been.
Yeah, and the disaster started maybe 10,000 years ago, but it was very slow, progressive things. Our brains got a little smaller. We had some problems. But over the last 50, maybe 100 years, we've really seen a dramatic change, because now we've taken those foods that were not naturally brought up on, and now we've even processed them more, made them less, because our ancestors knew something about this. They had the inclination to ferment. They had the inclination to put them aside for a long time so the bacteria could work. They distilled these things. Probably carbohydrates were just used for booze, I think, in the beginning, not for the other stuff.
Yeah, I learned a term
which is my philosophy.
That I termed from Sally Fallon at the Weston A. Price. Yes, you can. Yes, you can eat this food if you let it spoil and ferment and culture and et cetera.
Yeah. Pre-agricultural Paleolithic hunters and gatherers derived most of their calories from about 100 to 200 different species of wild animals, that's the meat and fat, being 90% of the diet, and also, to a lesser degree, lots of fibrous vegetables, greens, nuts, and fruits when they were in season.
Yeah, and so suddenly now all of about 17 species of plants today, most of which are entirely new to the human diet, are providing 90% of the world's food supplies.
And she says here, Nora says, this is insanely huge flip-flop.
Yeah.
And it's not been a healthy one.
The toll that it has taken upon our health, not to mention the health of the planetary environment, is immeasurable and tragic.
Yeah. And it's kind of, I can understand people having a hard time wrapping their head around this, because we've been really bombarded ever since TV has been on, that eat your whole grains, we need carbohydrates to be 60 or 70% of our diet. It's a complete shift of the way we were thinking. It's amazing how human beings have that short of a memory. Because if you look at the cookbooks from the 1700s, nowhere does it mention, it's all about the meat and the fat and how you're going to fix it. There's nothing
That's
mentioned
so
about
funny
vegetables.
That you said the cookbooks from the 1700s.
There isn't. The first real cookbook on vegetables, and actually not vegetables, on grains and baking was the Betty Crocker books.
Right, because the food industry sponsored old Betty. I don't even think Betty existed.
Pills.
I think she was made up.
Who knows? Well, if she wasn't, she made a lot of money.
Yeah, true.
Hopefully.
So, you know, all of a sudden we're promoting these health foods. I mean, when I was at the Weston Price Convention, Sally Fallon made a couple points. She had a picture of a bunch of kale. She goes, everyone thinks this is a superfood. She goes, this is a superfood. And she was showing butter and liver and so forth. I mean, she compared the nutrient density, and it was just there was no arguing that point. She was exactly right. And the energy and nutrient value of starch-based foods we have come to rely on in modern times are considerably inferior to animal foods, as I just suggested. Even after cooking, sugar-based foods in particular have led to an epidemic of metabolic disorders, including obesity, type 2 diabetes, cancer, hungry cancers that use sugars for food.
Remember the other day we were talking about how a cancer cell takes the sugar, puts it into the cell, ferments it to make a compound of fermented sugar that specifically works without oxygen.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, that tumor can isolate itself from the rest of the body and keep on growing.
It just says, come back and feed me.
That's right.
It just sits back.
Yeah.
So grains and legumes, much less refined carbohydrates, weren't necessarily all to blame for the poor health related to starch consumption in pre- and post-agricultural humans. There's an interesting study was published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences in January of 2014, which revealed that pre-agricultural starchy carbohydrate consumption led to ill health and dental disease in prehistoric hunter-gatherers from time to time as well. In other words, we can't blame it all on farming. The research team at Oxford University showed that widespread tooth decay occurred in a hunter-gatherer society in Morocco several thousand years before the dawn of agriculture. And they analyzed these adult teeth, and they found some decay and abscesses. So,
well, remember also what happened, especially in North America around 10 or 12,000 years ago. We know we were into a huge ice age. They had a meteor hit the ice caps above Canada, and that caused all kinds of flooding. And most of the large animals in the United States, in Canada, and also in Europe were gone. The only ones that were really left real large were in Australia and in Africa. That's where the large animals remained. We didn't have them anymore. So people, we were always very good. All the literature really shows us that we were very good at hunting those big animals because it gave us a lot for very little, because we're very smart animals. We know how to trap them. And of course, the large animals had all the fat too. Mm-hmm. Many stories, if you ever remember reading about Lewis and Clarke, mm-hmm. when they were at the Snake River, it was in the springtime. Springtime, the animals are very lean, and they were getting lots of deer and antelope and stuff like that, but they were starving because they didn't have the fat. The animals in the fall would be all fattened up and really good.
Right.
But with many, many stories about hunters eating deer and rabbit and everything like that and still starving because they weren't really. The Paleolithic people weren't eating the muscle meats. We were always eating the livers, the brains, everything but those things and all the fats and the skin and everything like
that. We live in an upside down world.
Yes, we do.
Yeah, and talking about more evidence that things were going wrong, just as we know Weston Price studied, here she goes. Nora's discussing the fact that dental abnormalities such as malocclusion and dental overcrowding. I mean, think about the orthodontia business.
Yeah.
I mean, from historic things we see these were not problems. And they first became common among the world's earliest farmers some 12,000 years ago in Southwest Asia, according to findings that were published in 2015. Pre-agricultural Paleolithic hunter-gatherers, on the other hand, had almost no malocclusion and dental crowding, demonstrating in research to date. So Science Daily article illuminated this same study that showed that the lower jaws of the world's earliest farmers are not simply smaller versions of those of the predecessor hunter-gatherers, but that the lower jaw underwent a complex series of shape change,
yeah.
Facial structure change, commensurate
with the transition. That's why we have the crowding, because it just starts going inward.
To agriculture, they didn't have that strong jaw. And I love looking at Weston A. Price's book, Nutrition and Physical Degeneration, and all his before and after pictures.
Yep.
He spent 40 years traveling mm-hmm. and making these
yeah.
studies of these cultures.
Right around the turn of the century, too, which is amazing.
They said that the hunter-gatherer populations had an almost perfect harmony between their lower jaw and their teeth, and it begins to fade when you examine the lower jaws and teeth of the earliest farmers.
Yeah, the diet of hunter-gatherers was based on hard foods like wild and cooked vegetables and meat, while the staple of the sedentary farmer is the soft cooked food and processed food like cereals and beans.
So the jaw lost its strength.
Yep.
Okay. Cool stuff, guys. We'll be right back. I'm taking a short break.
Yeah, please pick up some Primal Edge if I can get it up here to show it to you, and you'll be good to go.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be right back.
You know what's cool? Taking something that's good for you. Something specifically formulated to help with weight loss, better sleep, stress reduction, and the need to detox.
Nico, our hunter and gatherer ancestors found all their nutritional requirements for health in their wild environment. But today, our food sources no longer contain the vitamins, minerals, and nutrients our bodies need to stay healthy and strong.
That's why we need Primal Edge Daily Nutrition. It includes a special blend of ionic, soil-based vitamins, minerals, fatty, and amino acids in an easy-to-use liquid form.
Primal Edge is powered by highly concentrated folic and humic acids, nature's preferred delivery system. They have been called miracle molecules because, like sunlight, air, and water, life cannot exist without them.
That's right, Paige. They ensure we receive all the nutrition we need to be healthy and thrive.
We take it every morning. Primal Edge, formulated and approved by Nico and Paige of Living a Primal Lifestyle. Buy it today for just $89. Click on the Primal Edge banner on the front page of TFNN.com.
Tom O'Brien's weekly gold letter, The Gold Report, gives complete and concise coverage of the entire gold market. Inside, you'll get Tom's commentary on gold, the dollar, the rand, the bond, the XAU, the HUI, and detailed coverage of nearly 25 mining stocks. He'll give you the entry price, price target, and stop price of each stock trade. The Gold Report is a long-term newsletter where the focus is on building real wealth through the management of a successful portfolio of gold stocks. With a lifetime of knowledge and almost 12 years of writing his informative weekly newsletter, The Gold Report, Tom O'Brien can provide you with the important market information to help you make better trades in the gold market. Don't let the next bull run in gold pass you by. To get a month-long free trial to The Gold Report, an $85 value, visit the front page of TFNN.com today.
David White's newsletter, The Technology Insider, is focused like a laser on finding the next big things in technology. If you had invested only $10,000 in Microsoft in 1986, you'd have been a millionaire by 2000. Disruptive technology like Microsoft's is the key to these massive long-term profits, and The Tech Insider is the vehicle from TFNN to capitalize on these opportunities. This is the go-to newsletter that identifies, monitors, and profits on mostly little-known cutting-edge companies with great long-term prospects. David's experience is as an inventor of Emmy-winning animation products for TV and Hollywood that propelled a company public. Match that with 14 years as a full-time trader, and he's uniquely qualified to guide you through the light-speed world of ever-evolving high-tech. If you're ready to ride the next big technology bull market for less than $40 per month, log on to TFNN.com and get your two-week free trial to The Technology Insider. Get in on the ground floor of the next big thing today.
This segment is brought to you by TFNN. Test drive all the newsletters for free at TFNN.com.
And welcome back to the show. We've been talking about the Iceman that was found in 1991. 5,000-year-old carcass, and actually it was pretty complete, which is really
intact
cool.
Intact and complete, and he had all his treasures with him.
Yeah, this is a picture of what they found him like, and of course he had some clothing with him stuff, and this is
a computer-generated idea of what he might have looked like. Yeah. He was
kind of cool. Mm-hmm. In short, we humans were fundamentally designed by our evolutionary selective pressures and earliest dietary preferences to be fatheads, not potato heads, or acorn heads, as Nora says,
much less grain brains. So ketones, the basic energy unit of fat, along with free fatty acids, are an extremely abundant, reliable, stable, and steady source of fuel for our bodies that we were actually designed to run on, even in the absence of meals.
And regular meals,
for sure. So furthermore, our brain cells and are more vulnerable than just about any other tissue to the ravages of glycation and the oxidation of free radicals than any other tissue. And we see this in the situation of the oxidation and use of sugars. We get these damaged proteins.
I like
proteins.
What she talks about, units of fat, which are extremely reliable, abundant, and stable. And this, what she's really talking about here are the saturated fats, because we know that the omega polyunsaturated fats, even the monounsaturated fats that come from plants, are unstable, are hard to digest. But what will help this in our bodies is that saturated fat, something that we've actually been told for the last 50 years to avoid. This is the protection of those fats that are unstable.
That is right on, Nico, exactly.
And it's so important, because you take any kind of polyunsaturated fat, put it on the table, it goes rancid. We know that our bodies are hotter than room temperature.
Right, and so actually that's why all these oils are actually rancid in the store. As you see them in their cheap plastic bottles, they're rancid beforehand.
You need glass bottles, you need the dark glass bottles.
If you want flax oil, then grind your own flaxseed, because right then, don't buy something that's already pressed.
And also, I'd recommend taking flax with perhaps some of the animal-based ones, because the flax has a hard
time. Sprinkle it on some butter.
Well, it has a hard time being digested by us by itself. But
if
you mix the two, the digestion process is faster. So if you want to take advantage of some of these great vegetable oils, even the vegetable proteins, you need the animal source to protect those things.
And that is a lot of the work that you and I have discussed on this show by Dr. Ray Peet, whose brilliant work talking about the damaging effects because of this oxidative stress of PUFAs, polyunsaturated fats, and always perhaps carry a vitamin E capsule in case you're in a restaurant because you get them. All restaurants use soy oil, which are not even desirable ones, and try and eat your animal foods because you got the saturated fats and what
that's
comes
that's a good
with
point,
them.
Too. And, you know, of course, we've been told that these things really need to be in us, and people are taking those omega-3s, but we need the other ones to protect it. And this is pretty new in the last couple of years. Norv has been writing about it, D'Agostino at the University of South Florida, and his cancer research has been talking about the protective qualities of saturated fats. Very important to understand that they are the protection for us, and this is what we've been told. So no wonder we've got the grain eating, and we've got the away from these protective properties of foods. So between the two of them, we're going in the wrong direction. We're spreading it farther apart. We need to get it closer together.
And
saturated
yet people
fat.
Still have this fear of saturated fat. I was at a restaurant and a lady was sitting next to me and her husband went to the restroom and I don't know, she and I started chatting and then she was like apologizing. She goes, well, we try to eat red meat but only once a month. You know, my husband has heart disease. And I said, well, he probably needs to eat some healthier, you know, grass-fed red meat and instead of the pastas and this kind of a thing. But there's still such an ingrained thought that they need to be fearful of saturated fats, and that's just not true.
Well, people hear what they want to hear. It's sometimes as you're talking to them and they say, oh yeah, that sounds great, and then when you visit them a month later, they're back on the whole thing. Well, I thought this is what you said. You know, it's like the guy in jiu-jitsu who came a couple of years back, and he, you know, I did a whole talk for about 15 minutes before the class started about different foods and things, and he came back the next week. He says, I think you'll be proud of me, I started juicing.
Yeah, because they,
Wait a minute here. Now I got to start all over here. You know, all the things that we said just went over.
Yeah. And, you know, how many people, too, say, oh, I'm really trying to eat healthier, but I've got a big event, or I've got an exam, or I've got a court, I've got something to fight. I can't go without my carbs because my brain needs sugar. But the brain actually prefers ketones as a fuel source. It's a cleaner burning fuel source, and it's a preferred source of energy in both our heart muscles and our renal cortex and our kidneys. But your brain can use it if it needs to, and it's and it really actually runs great on ketones.
It does, and of course, the brain, if it needs sucrose, will convert the ketones to the sucrose because it knows what
to do. It knows what to do.
It's the volatile.
The glucose, you mean.
Yeah, the glucose. It's the volatile sugar, the volatile grains, all these volatile little foods, the starches that we put in our body that our body really has trouble with, and hence we become inflammatory in most of our modern diseases. Love that inflammation. You're being irritated, your body goes into a mode of trying to repair and replace these things. You're in a repair mode, but you're not in that maintenance mode that we like to be in, which is nice and calm.
You know, every time I look at this article, because Nora always has a way of just, almost every sentence you read gives you that aha moment. She said, nature was beyond wise to design us this way, to being able to use these ketones as fuel. But unfortunately, most people today fail to take advantage of this incredibly elegant and efficient design, and instead we divert away from the energy we were mostly meant to rely upon, and we are forcing ourselves into this unnatural and enslaving dependence upon carbohydrates as a primary source of fuel. And who benefits from that? The food companies.
So we're actually have a country, and this is probably worldwide in a sense, that is using food to get their businesses going, to keep the businesses going without the regard to health. Yeah, they'll put some healthy stuff in there if they have to, but they'd rather have food that lasts a long time on the shelf and doesn't have the spoilage factor of fresh food. And that's the problem with fresh food. You go to a farmer's market, whatever you're taking home, you either have to consume or start doing something to it so it'll last longer. It won't be in that same vein that you have it. You're not gonna, you know, when you go to markets in Europe, and I know you know this, everything out there is hanging up. The meat, everything's nothing's
fresh.
Refrigerated.
And most of the refrigerators in the homes are the size of a portable refrigerator we put at our office to put our, someone puts in their office so they can have their sodas and stuff. I mean, literally, they go each day. It's just there to keep some stuff there for a day or so.
And then when you go each day looking for food, I think it changes your mind about what food actually is. Also gives you a chance to talk to the people who are supplying the food, because now you're at a farmer's market or maybe a butcher shop of some kind. That's different than being in a large department store of food.
So I like what Nora says here. It's well past time that we take the USDA pyramid and turn it over on its head. And we often say we're living in an upside-down world, and we think that Oitzi, the Neolithic guy, would well agree based on what's happened, because Americans have been following the rules and taking the mainstream government guidelines to heart, literally, in their dietary choices. And as we have done this obediently, we have followed the rules, the sicker, the more obese we have become as a society, and we have traded our precious animal source foods for carbs and these animal fats for vegetable oils that have created havoc on our health.
One of the things we recommend is to recommend Nora's book, The Primal Fat Burner. Highly intelligently written, and will actually blow your mind of how deep she goes into this. And this is exactly what we're talking about. We're going to be right back, folks.
Hi, I'm Steve Rhodes, host of The Trader's Edge, heard daily at TFNN.com and author of Mastering Probability, a daily investment and trading newsletter service that I send out each morning by 8 a.m. My morning newsletter service covers exactly what the markets have been doing since last night's close, providing you with an edge on your trading day ahead. You get actionable trading ideas, including the exact entry, stop, and profit targets. Plus, I'll teach you the patterns and hidden market correlations that will make you a better trader. As a subscriber, you'll gain access to my 90-minute money management workshop, where I'll teach you the secrets that'll save your assets. The bottom line, I've got your back, including a 30-day money-back guarantee. See for yourself the type of analysis I provide each trading day by signing up for Mastering Probability today. With nothing to lose, this is an offer you should not pass on. Mastering Probability can be found under trading newsletters on the front page of TFNN.com.
If you're an active trader looking for that extra edge when it comes to trading and investments, then now is a great time to get a 2-week free trial to Tom O'Brien's daily market letter, Market Insights. Tom O'Brien's daily newsletter, Market Insights, comes out every market day at around 9:30 a.m. and provides Tom's daily commentary on the broad market, including the Dow, NASDAQ, and S&P, plus specific trade recommendations. There's even an update published most afternoons to keep you informed about the day's market activity. He'll give you the entry price, price target, and stop price of each stock and option trade. With Market Insights, there's nothing left to guessing. For all the details and to get your 2-week free trial to Market Insights started today, visit TFNN.com.
No matter where you're listening to TFNN programming, you can always access your favorite shows on demand through TFNN.com. TFNN airs live programming every market day from 8 a.m. till 6 p.m. Eastern, and you can view each program by accessing Tiger TV through our homepage. We even have an easy link for all mobile devices, including iPhones, iPads, and Android devices, located in the top right-hand corner of the TFNN homepage. You can use your smartphone to view Tiger TV. But if you don't have a connection that can keep up with streaming live video, then you can simply visit tfnn.mobi in the browser of your smartphone for live streaming audio of all our programs. The mission of TFNN is to educate our audience directly and interactively through our interactive website and call-in talk shows. TFNN is able to teach all levels of investors the technical skills needed to trade in today's marketplace. In order to get the best information possible, TFNN has assembled the most respected financial minds in the country to provide the most current news and comprehensive advice available. TFNN.com, educating investors. Join John Logan as he teaches you trading techniques utilizing the TAS Profile Scanner, the Global Market Pulse, next on TFNN.
Let's talk about 6 reasons you might be nutrient depleted and the solutions. You know, in a country where obesity is epidemic, it might seem contradictory that most of us are actually starving for nutrients. And the truth is most of us are overfed and undernourished. Mm-hmm.
That's true. That's amazing. We see a lot of heavy people, and if they're undernourished, that's no good. Number one is the inadequate nutrient intake. It's no surprise that the most common cause of nutrient depletion is poor food choices. According to the CDC press release, not one state population is consuming enough fruits and vegetables to get their phytonutrients
to get the
bodies.
Right micronutrients. And, you know, the fruits and vegetables are kind of concentrators of the micronutrients that should be in the soil.
Yeah, and that's amazing that we don't get enough since, you know, we're shipping this stuff all over the place. And it's better if we eat seasonally, but, you know, it's available all the time. So how come we're not getting it?
Yeah. And then number two, there's poor nutrient absorption. Well, why is that? Well, what we've also learned, if you've listened to our show, is that we really need our fat-soluble activators to cleave these minerals from the fruits and vegetables so that we can absorb them. So in addition to the poor choices, millions of people are living with gastrointestinal disorders that make it difficult to absorb and utilize what little nutrients there are in the foods today. Let's give you a couple examples.
Yes.
Celiac disease.
Crohn's disease.
Ulcerative colitis. Just general gut dysbiosis, meaning it's out of balance.
And then low stomach acid, which we all have. And as we age, the stomach acid is naturally produced, and mainly because we're not using a lot of it.
Because we're not eating the meats and fats we were designed to eat, like we talked about earlier today.
Number three is nutrient-depleted meat and produce. Conventional farming practices. Administration of growth hormones.
Yeah, they're adding stuff into the food.
Antibiotics, grain-based feed for the animals, which aren't used to eating seeds. Remember, they're seeds. They're not plants. These are plant-eating animals, not seed-eating animals.
Right.
If you look up in the dictionary or Wikipedia, whatever, you're going to look for seed eaters. You'll find birds are seed eaters.
And yet they were feeding these grazing animals seeds when they don't thrive on that. And that's why they get sick, and then there's the need for antibiotics. And again, long distance shipping of food is really decreasing the quantity of it. But
number four
is we have an elevated nutrient requirement. Many of us are due to poor absorption, gut lining issues. We're having conditions where we need more. We're under more stress today.
Yeah,
we really have a higher demand for nutrients. You know, I told you, I shared my personal story that you know, been doing some moving and shifting a family, and
that's stressful.
And I had signs of just B vitamin deficiency, and I just doubled up on my Primal Edge, and it really helped.
Number five is changes in metabolism. Metabolism is triggered by environmental pollution, excessive alcohol consumption, drugs, and certain diseases are all so common causes of malnutrition. So by substituting things in there that we don't have or not being able to get rid of those environmental things, you're going to have to, you know, get more vitamins in for sure.
Oh, yeah, sure. And number six, actually low food diversity, eating the same foods over and over again. Mm-hmm. This can create a situation where your body sees the food as a threat. It's overwhelmed with dealing with the same types of food.
And
just shake it up a bit.
Yeah, and I think it's not as much of a problem in eating animals as it is in eating the vegetables. I think the vegetables have to be more diverse, where the animals maybe not as much. And the last one is that the nutrient depletion of the soil. And what we're seeing is that there is not the adequate nutrition in our soil today. One of the reasons that we decided with the Primal Edge.
We created the Primal Edge, which is an opportunity to get the nutrients that were available to our ancestors in ancient soil beds. These micronutrients that are in the micronized fulvic humic acid help you to make sure you're getting exactly what you need. But it's important to be aware of how you might be running low on some of these nutrients and find a solution.
Yeah, and do your own research, folks. And of course, John Logan is next on TFNN with the Global Market Pulse. So stay tuned for that. Stay tuned the whole afternoon for all our shows. We'll be right back next week.
Since 1984, Basil Chapman has been using the Chapman Wave methodology to advise traders of his expert market opinion. While originally hand-drawing charts from the late 1970s into the 1980s, Basil noticed that prices under most circumstances virtually always had a certain number of legs to the upside before declining sharply. Later, Basil found that computer software, which included the standard market technical indicators, enhanced the degree of accuracy in calling price turns as well as market trend calls. Thus was born the Chapman Wave sequence. Using the Chapman Wave methodology along with other indicators, Basil Chapman advises his subscribers of his expert market opinion each market day with his opening call newsletter. Right now, you can get a two-week free trial to the opening call, Basil's daily trading newsletter, by visiting the front page of TFNN.com. Cancel at any time during that trial and pay absolutely nothing. Get your two-week free trial to Basil's newsletter, The Opening Call, today by visiting TFNN.com.
You're watching Tiger TV.